a very brief introduction to the problem dealing with the approach to the study of the Islamic elements in the archaeology of Russia. It's a little bit exotic name for the paper. Let's start with the first book of 1879 on the history of the medieval Russian art. Its author was a prominent French student of the art styles, Viollet le Duc. His book was officially approved by the Russian government. Le Duc attempted to understand the phenomenon of the culture of the Rus as a part of the Oriental culture, originated from the Scythian, Islamic, and even Indo-Chinese art, too far, of course, from Russia. The idea was a simple one and quite understandable. Russia had the wide zone for contact between the Christian and Islamic worlds. The Islamic states did exist at her territory, and the others were bordered with the country. The earliest one, Bulgaria of the Middle Volga, was converted to Islam at the end of the 10th century. Islam prevailed here after the Mongol invasion of the middle 13th century. The descendants of Genghis Khan built the westernmost Mongolian Khanate, the Ulus of Juchi, also known as the Golden Horde. In its zone of possession was, between the others, northeastern Rus. The Golden Horde was demolished by Tamerlan mainly, but it gave birth to the four new Islamic Khanates of the 15th and 16th centuries, namely to Kazan, Astrakhan, Siberia, and Crimea. The latter one became in the 16th century the vassal of the Ottoman Empire, and Ottomans possessed also a good portion of what today are Moldova and Ukraine. Caucasus, remote from Moscow both in terms of the space and time, was at the early modern period mainly Islamic, and Russia would incorporate Caucasus as well as the good portion of the Islamic Central Asia for two centuries. To make a long story short, the Russian history was accompanied by Islam since its childhood, and the Islamic influences are not locked inside this or that episodes. We feel the breeze of Islam in the main points of the national narrative, and many of them have an archaeological dimension. For example, the Arabic silver coins appears alongside the route from Mediterranean to the Northern Europe. Or the founder of Rus, Vladimir the Prince, as he is showing, choosing the religion. The dramatic Mongol invasion, and there were plenty of warriors from the Islamic Central Asia, is marked by the famous hordes, including two hordes of Moscow. The intermingling of elites of Russia and the Golden Horde in the 14th and 16th and 15th centuries is expressed in the birchbark letter of Kremlin with its long list of the Oriental and Russian names and dozens of battle horses. In the 16th century would start the Moscow Reconquista, slowly absorbing Islamic neighbors to the Tsardom of Moscow and later of St. Petersburg's empire. And this was the result. We see here the great Islamic belt at the eastern and southern borders of Rus. Constant connection, all the forms of interaction, trade and exchange of the population, political alliances, wars and accessions. There are even examples of the deliberate conservation of the Islamic puppet state inside the Muscovy, such as the Tsardom of Kasimov or Mishore Yurt, where the rulers and their subjects kept the Islam up to the late 17th century and partly today, of course. All it means that the Russian Orthodox culture and the Islamic societies of the northern Eurasia were both neighbors and relatives. They were a kind of a family joined together by the long-lasting experience of coexistence. Certainly, there are plenty of books dealing with the role of Islam in the political system of Russia, with the Oriental elements in our language, in the state ceremonials, and so forth. Up to the late 20th century, the scholars readily and a priori strove to the same scheme in art and archaeology. But we can see today with no success. Let me give you some examples. The tiles for the facade decoration were in fashion in Moscow of the 16th and especially of the 17th centuries. As it is well known, the wall decoration is the brand of the Islamic architecture, including the golden hort, I mean with the tiles or glazed bricks. Does it mean that the tiles came to Russia from the Orient? Not at all. It was proved that the technology, shape, and artistic style were brought to Moscow from Europe, firstly as the terracotta of Italy. The ornamentation could be oriental due to the patterns of the textile of India or Turkey. But the ceramic patterns were made firstly in Europe, and the way is from there to Moscow. A similar picture with the emergence of the tent-like motifs in the building style of Russian churches. For a long time, it was assumed that the root for the clearly orientalized architecture of the cathedral of the protection of Our Lady at the Red Square, also known as Basil the Blessed, are somehow Islamic. The church was erected devota for the victory over the Kazan Khanate in the middle of the 16th century. In this case, similar to the depiction of the minaret in the Crimean War Church of Istanbul built by the English architect, no? But no. It was proved that the roots of the tent-like construction of Moscow are concealed in the Western tradition. It is a very late branch of the monastic order's architecture. It is the embodiment of the idea of the transmission of the holy places to Europe, and in our case in Moscow. The Russian part of the route started at the 16th century with the erection of the Ascension Church at the Tsar's summer residence here. It was a sort of a castle chapel, closely related to the long line of the Holy Sepulchre images. The last one at the most exact replica of the temple was built in the late 17th century near Moscow at the New Jerusalem. So, the form of the cathedral at the Red Square is the fantastic architecture and looking oriental, but it reflects strictly Christian prototype and in reality has nothing to do with oriental architecture at all. Well, don't we have any positive results of the hunting for the Islamic elements? There are a couple of them in the field of architectural plastic. The first one deals with the field of the stone carving of the early 15th century. At that moment, Moscow rulers did erected several buildings with flat and plain facades. It was possible to implement to them the long bands of the carved decoration. The masters of these complicated carved ornaments originated from the Golden Horde, namely from Crimea, closely related to Anatolia. Moscow had a permanent trade connection to the Crimea with its Genoese and Armenian colonies, and it was relatively easy to get the craftsmen. The important feature of this new decorative style was the composition of the stepped friezes with the motifs, typical for the mosque, turbe, and caravanserai of Seljuk and Seljukids Anatolia. Let me show just some examples. Not Anatolia, of course, you know, up to the Jerusalem and Egypt. But mainly Turkish. In the Russian ornamental tradition, it was a very short episode, I would say, hapax legomenon. But one of the motifs as an arabesque was accepted and survived until the 16th century, probably due to its popular character for Europe. The next case study belongs to the period of the flourishing Moscow culture of the 17th century. In that time, we could see a special group of the tombstone decoration at the cemeteries both of Kazan and Moscow, including the dynastic necropolis in the Moscow Kremlin. You see this wonderful example from Kazan, absolutely Turkish, actually. We could suppose also the influence of the Arabic calligraphy to the decorative style of Russian inscriptions, known as vyazh, or weaving. There are some examples of this. The Arabic calligraphic styles were well known in Moscow since at least the 13th century due to the intermingling of the Golden Horde and the Russian coinage up to the late 15th century. You see here the Russian coins with the Arabic inscriptions. Here, in the field of the everyday life with its small artifacts, the connections of Moscow with the world of Islam maybe would be more visible. To the period of the Golden Horde, we can connect the new stratum of Moscow embellished by the Oriental imports. Here you see the finds of the recent excavations nearby Kremlin in Zaryadye, in the earliest Rabat of Moscow. Those of you who come to Moscow definitely would come to Zaryadye. The archaeology has to pay attention to the less investigated fields, such as the very important sphere of the horse trade, the decisive element of Russian power of the medieval period. It would be of use to observe the field of the Oriental glass production, we have seen it today, and to establish an area of spread of glass bracelets and the points of their workshops more precisely than it is now. The pottery production could also shed light, and Vladimir Kovalev and Niva are doing in this field. It should be a special paper. We could also deal more with the weaponry and so forth. Also, we have to find the space for jewelry, for the really striking examples of the courtly art, like crowns and ceremonial helmets, including those with the text of the Quran. Certainly, we would consider all this as a part of the general picture of the early European Orientalism. But for the history of the material culture, it wouldn't be enough for the representation of Moscow as the real contact zone. We have much more examples of the Western impulses than the Western or Southern ones. Even the undisputably Oriental objects often appeared to be the European re-export, as this one from the far Near East, from Korea or China. For the conclusion, let's compare Moscow with the main zones of exchange of Europe and the world of Islam. There are well-known cases of incorporation and multiple reuse of churches and chapels to mosques and back again. The same is true for the copy of the buildings. For example, the Turks heavily reused the Byzantine churches and built symbolic replicas of them too. In Moscow, we have nothing of the kind, as well as no Islamic cemeteries, such a big country, until the very late 18th century. All it means is that the understanding of the Islamic influence at the material culture of Muscovy is greatly overestimated. And we have to consider that the very limited impact of the Islam architecture and decorative art as the phenomenon. Certainly, the experience of the colleagues would be important, as well as the cooperation in the field of study of the Islamic, Jewish, and Christian world interaction. Thank you. That's it.